Dadville on the podcast. Dave Barnes, John McLaughlin. How did you guys get Nate Bargatze on?
Is he doing too much talking, do you think?
This is kind of how it goes.
Did Billy Joel's music teach you how to play piano? Everyone's freaking out about the Sabrina Carpenter song, Please, 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 because it has that key change in the second verse. Any place where you guys receive revenue, where it might be surprising to know that you actually receive revenue from that place? Walked in here talking about Aerosmith. First of all, Dadville is on the podcast this week.
Oh, we've started.
We've already started.
In true Dadville form, one of us showed up late because he was dropping his kids off. And we don't need to say who that was.
I feel like maybe we should.
No, I don't think we need
well,
to.
Well, here's my thing, okay? Because this is
let
where
the people work it out in the
this
comments.
This was the first mistake that you made. Okay, here's my thing. My thing is if I'm running late to a meeting and it's only gonna be a couple minutes. I never text, I'm running a couple minutes late, because for all I know, they're going to be late. And sometimes you end up beating them.
Here's the thing, though. I can see where Dave is.
Yeah.
And
he was late, too.
Well, I walked out of my house, and we live across the street from each other.
You were a couple minutes late, Dave. Were a couple minutes late. Okay. Let's not.
See, now I'm giving myself away. I walk out of the house. Dave's car's already gone. I'm like, dang it. And then, I drop my kids off, and then I see where Dave is, and I can see he's already almost here.
So that's when I called you at 8:57.
You called me?
You called me at 8:57?
I was not late.
Well, now I feel bad.
But were you in the room, though?
No, that's the thing.
I was in the
No. By the time we got here, it was basically 8:10. It was I had to go find him. I had to go do the whole thing.
He was sweating by the time he got to me.
Yeah. Yeah. Wait, okay, first of all, I have a lot to talk about. This is so early. I want everyone to know this is 9 a.m., okay? Yeah. Which is early. Maybe not for you guys.
L.A. time, it's 7.
If you go L.A. time,
You go Hawaii.
Let's go to Hawaii.
Let's go to Hawaii.
Can we pull that data up?
It's even earlier. So these people are up early. These guys are dads.
We are.
Is Dadville. These guys are dads. They've been doing the podcast for how many years? When did you start the podcast?
For June 2020. Four and something.
So it's
years.
Been like four.
John is our numbers guy.
It's a little too early for that data to even be up today.
To even be sure. Hey,
it'll be in by noon.
Hold on. Is it dad?
Dada.
How have we buy that.com? Okay. Can you jump on there real
quick? Dada.com.
GoDaddy.com.
What if you just don't buy it right now and then you find out it was bought within the hour?
Yeah. Yeah.
You just wait till after the podcast.
We have
it was bought
listeners.
15 minutes from
That's
now.
Right. That's right
now.
That's
yeah,
right.
Yeah. Wait, but in all seriousness, you've been doing the podcast for years. You guys live busy lives. Why do you still do it? Like, is it that fun? Or like, why do you do the podcast?
Dave, go ahead.
Okay. We entered into an agreement. And years ago, and it said we had to do it for 6 years. And
is that
both
true?
Of us, no. No, we actually
that
talk
could
about
be true.
It
I
could
don't
be
know.
True. Yeah. You'll never know. We actually talk about this a lot. It's just really, I mean, this sounds really cheesy. It's really fun. And I think we both get to talk to, I mean, some of the ones that come to top of mind, like, I can't think of another reason that I would ever have a conversation with, like, Bruce Hornsby. I mean, I hope that we would meet in the musical world somewhere, but, or Matthew McConaughey or like Kirk Herbstreit or, there's just so many guests we have on that I'm like, I love that there's a venue for me to sit and have a conversation, John and I, with somebody that probably out in the natural world we may not ever come in contact with. And then too selfishly, which we talk a lot about, is that we just both learn so much. You get, it feels like one or two times in every conversation, somebody will say something that I'm like, oh, that's a really interesting thought, especially as we call them like the specialists that we have on, like people who kind of specialize in either therapy or counseling or have written books on child development or something. Those are like, it feels like you're just, drinking from a fire hydrant and some of those, because there's just so much great information. But so I think it's a combination of selfish that we learn things, and then two, that we just really enjoy it. Like, and two, it's not, I mean, candidly, it's not a ton of work to do. We have a really great producer, Jason, who helps. And so I think if it was even a little more of a job.
I mean, honestly, if we didn't have Jason, I'm not sure.
We wouldn't do it.
We would just be making recordings and like emailing them out.
Throwing hard drives into the yard.
Yeah.
Hoping that some.
What have you learned about interviewing from doing the show? Because you have to look back. You have to feel like you've become better
We've
interviewers.
We've learned to never ask that question.
That's the question.
That's kind of the cardinal
never
sin.
The cardinal sin is that question right
it's
there.
It's so great to be here for you, though.
Yeah,
for
yeah.
For you to learn it in real time.
No, that's what I want.
That's what I want to happen. I'm trying to million, but I start my podcast in 2020 also.
Uh-huh. Oh, nice.
Yeah. Well, this isn't really about me, but
hey,
but
we can be.
It can. Can we make it about me?
You're sitting with
you
interviewers.
You just showed us that it can be about you.
You're sitting with two professional interviewers, and enough, we can turn the tables on enough, without you even knowing.
Enough about me, though. Tell me more about what you guys think of me.
Okay, yeah. So far, it's been great. I mean, starting with Aerosmith and Spin Doctors earlier this week.
Yeah.
I mean, I think something that a couple things I would say that I feel like I've
learned.
Is he
doing too much talking? Do you think?
This is kind of how it goes.
Should John be saying? I just want to be sure that you know that Dave's not doing. Dave Barnes is not
as
doing too
I
much of
the
talking.
Talking, I honest to God.
No,
I went,
keep going. It's
all,
it's fine.
Just let John in. No, you go, John.
Dave, you really feel like you're on a roll.
Honestly, like I think the two of us, because of what you just witnessed, have completely different paths to learning. You know what I mean? With the interview. Because I have to learn. I mean, truthfully, in all seriousness, a huge part of our podcast is Dave Barnes being Dave Barnes and being hilarious and being, you know, funny and all that. And that's a big part of the vibe of the podcast. And so early on, I really had to be thoughtful about, like, the cardinal sin that I could commit is like, I'm going to jump in and try to be Dave Barnes 2.0. That would be the worst. That's just not me. I cannot. This is as high octane as I can go right now. This is my, and I'm even slowing down in real time. So I think for me, I'm like, okay, I personally, once the interview starts, I kind of want to feel like I've already contributed. So Dave and I will get together beforehand and sit for like an hour, and we'll bring all of our questions that we have. And so by that time, I want to feel like if they have a book, like I've read a good portion of their book, if not the whole thing, or like if they've got music, I've listened to it, and I've put together some thoughts. So by the time we get to the interview, I want to feel like, okay, I've written down some good questions that we're going to use, whether I ask them or Dave asks them. And that to me kind of sets me at ease. And then I can feel like I don't need to prove myself or whatever. And then it's just kind of, it's taken some time for me to just kind of calm down and not feel like I need to say anything. But then just like, if I have a question that I'm in real time wanting to ask, I can ask it. But it's a lot less busy in my head now than it was that first interview. It was tough for me to find my footing early on.
And you know, I think the thing, you know this from doing interviews, I mean, we joked about the cardinal sins, but John and I last week were talking about this exact thing. Like, it's really hard. I think it's really hard. That's not hard. You know, making railroads is hard. This is not hard. But one of the hard things about it is you just actually alluded to this. Like, you want to relate to your guests. The hard thing about relating to them is not over talking when you relate. In other words, like, mm-hmm. people that know you, they know you really well, listen to this, because you've said a lot about yourself over these last 4 or 5 years. Like, they know pretty much the ins and outs.
You know what's funny, though? I actually don't think I have.
You haven't? Okay.
Like, I don't think I have. In fact, someone said to me that they wish I spoke more about myself.
Okay, well, then you do it well. Then you're actually
going to
make
that point.
Maybe, I don't know. But I think something that John and I talk about is something I really struggle with is I think it's a pretty natural human thing to, when you, if we're interviewing you and you go, oh, well, I went to Mississippi State, I would then go, oh my gosh, I'm from Mississippi. And so I'd want to make a connection point. But in that, you don't want to over make that connection point, because one, people would go, oh, we already know that I didn't go to Mississippi State, but like Dave went, why is he saying this again? Because they don't realize in the real moment, I'm just trying to connect and make us all comfortable and have a connection. And so you have to be careful to not sort of like say the same things over and over in every interview for a connection point, because your listeners can go like, why are we talking about this again?
We know. I always like the Larry King quote, which is, I has no place in an interview.
There you go. There you go. And that is really hard. I mean, ironically, interview, the word is started
with an I.
With I. And
right,
so then one could say,
he wasn't great at spelling.
There's no.
Though. Right,
right.
He was notoriously a bad speller.
Yeah, that was exactly
right.
He would say ENT because it's an interview.
Right.
It's entertaining. Yes. I digress.
But you know what's interesting about that, what you said? Like, two things. One, it's interesting, the things that we have our eye on often are the things that we do. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That you had your eye on what? Like in an interview?
Like
or?
Dave has his eye on, let's not talk about ourselves too much and insert ourselves in the conversation. But that is something that Dave, part of your personality is sharing and you're a great conversationalist. And a big part of that is, you know, not in a bad way, but talking about yourself and relating with people in that way. It's just, it's interesting what we have our eye on just in general. It oftentimes is a thing that we do and we're on some level conscious of it, but sometimes it's like sort of like a superpower that we have.
Well, John, it's funny because John's superpower is he will come in with questions that are so unbelievably well laid out. I always joke, John is always, if you listen to Dadville and the guest says, God, what a great question, it's always
John's
a John question.
It's not
it's
always
100% a John question. But my favorite thing that John does is like, and he'll read them because they're great. And I'm like, I read the question. Don't skip. Because, you know, it's usually about three or four sentences because he sort of builds to the question.
Yeah.
But he will always joke later that like at about the third sentence, he's like, just shut up. This is taking forever. Get to the question. Where I'm like, no, like, this is
keep
great.
Going,
and so his insecurity, which is his superpower, is like, oh, God, this is taking way too long.
I feel like I talk too much.
How did you guys get Nate Bargatze on? Is that, was that through a dad network?
We have some pictures.
You have pictures on him.
Yeah. We've already said too much.
Yeah.
Right.
That, can we cut this out?
Even that was promised that it would never get brought up. But is there like a dad circle? Because isn't he a local dad?
He's
basically
a local dad. He's
like,
an LD.
Do you have a connection with him through that? Or like, how'd you get him on?
I don't remember.
Yeah, I just emailed his wife. Now, granted, this was, you know, what, two years ago? Yeah,
so
a couple
maybe
years
he wasn't
ago.
At the
He was
level of
in
success.
His ascendancy, but not where he is now. We actually have a million mutual friends. And I would maybe even go so bold as say that I know him now. Like we've been in a few times where we, whatever. But at the time, his wife, so one of our dearest friends is his stylist and has been forever. And so I was kind of like, you think she'd do this or he'd do this? And she said, maybe, but his wife is the one to kind of go through to get to him because she was at the time booking his stuff. And so I'd emailed her a couple of times and she kept saying like, I think this would be great. It's not the time. And then I think at some point she just was like, hey, like we can do it. And I'm going to say that. And then Jason's going to be like, no, I booked it. But I'm pretty sure she and I were emailing at least initially.
This is Dave's answer. This is not Dad's.
Did you learn anything? Because you do a little bit of comedy. Mm-hmm. Did you learn anything from that conversation with him about comedy?
No, but I won't listen to the interview because you can hear me so badly trying to relate sort of as a small-time comedian. And I just was like,
he was so gracious. Oh, you do comedy? I do comedy.
He was so gracious because it would literally be like me or John talking to someone who's like, I played out at this coffee house once and it was crazy. Isn't it crazy how crowds can be fill in the blank and you're like, so you just did like one show at a coffee house one time and now you're saying
yeah
you know?
right yeah
so I'm
no
like,
but I was listening to the interview recently I didn't think it sounded like
okay
that.
Good I was yeah. I know I got done and I was like oh Dave just like,
do you listen back to your own interviews
every single interview
you
no
do.
Way
yeah well first of all I do all my own editing
okay
so I feel like I have to but I feel like I view it like game tape like I
yeah,
like I
yeah,
get
yeah.
really excited to watch back and then I think when I listen to my older interviews or when I was like doing all these things that you don't even realize you're doing, like ums or likes or just like hesitating or not trying to be as confident as I could be. And then I would try to fix those things.
Yeah.
And I don't think I would have fixed those things or at least as quickly if I wasn't listening back. So mm-hmm. I listen back to everything. And sometimes I listen back multiple times.
Wow.
Yeah. And then sometimes I'm walking in the streets of New York or wherever and I go, what was that conversation I had with like Seth Godin or whatever? And I'll pull it up and I'll listen to it again, which
is
so arrogant.
Who are your top five?
Top five interviews I've done.
Let's just go ahead and can't. We know this one.
You don't have to say it.
This one's
with a bullet.
Top six. So now what's
with
two
a bullet.
Through six?
Yeah. The I had Bobby Bones on the 100th episode of my show.
Oh, dude, Bobby.
And I took
great.
A billboard out to get him on the show, and it worked. And I actually I did a whole list of stunts to try to book him on the show, and none of them worked. I bought a cameo from Carly Pierce. That didn't work. And finally, I took a billboard out in Midtown. Asking him to come on the show.
That is genius.
And he saw it. He came on the show. And that was probably, that was up there. Brad Paisley, who's the reason I got into country music easily. That got set up in a really funny way. And I spent 90 minutes at his house. And then we spent 5 hours after just like hanging, playing guitar.
Oh my gosh.
That was top.
Is that required for every guest? I just Are we doing 5 hours?
We're gonna do 5 hours after this.
That's okay. Do you have your? I didn't know.
Yeah. Are you cool with that?
I'll
okay, great.
Have to refill the meter.
Oh, that's fine. That's fine. That was up there, and then I don't know if you know who Seth Godin is.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Come on.
I've had Seth Godin on twice.
Jeez.
But that was really special. That was three. But those are the three. Oh, you know what? Here's the last one. Then I'm gonna kick it to you guys. I had Billy Gibbons on.
Oh yeah.
From ZZ Top.
Yeah.
This was a couple years ago. And a friend of mine, one of my best friends from college, is a massive ZZ Top fan, massive Billy Gibbons fan. And we had this game together where we were like trying to see who was going to meet Billy Gibbons first.
No way.
And I had an opportunity to meet him that fell through. And I was kind of like rubbing it in his face. And then he had an opportunity to meet him that also fell through. He was like, guess what? I'm going to meet Billy Gibbons tomorrow. I'm going to beat you to it. And it fell through. It was kind of like this game we were playing. So I get this interview. And it's the only time I've ever had a co-host. I lock in the interview and I called my friend.
No.
And I said,
dude, I love that.
I got the interview,
much.
But I'm going to bring you with me. We're going to do it together. And we both freaked out. And the best part was we're in this interview, and at the end of it, this is off air. We ended up talking with him for like another hour. And we were like, Billy, where do you get your clothing? Where do you get your jackets? And he talks about that. Everyone always talks about Nudie Cohen. Mm. Everyone always talks about Manuel. But nobody talks about Jaime, who was the seamstress in Nudie Cohen's shop
as a
teenager
I know about that.
North Hollywood.
Yep.
And he goes, let's call him right now. And he calls Jaime, and Jaime goes, Senor Gibbons, which is just what he sounded like. He was like, Senor Gibbons, like, you know, this thick accent. And Billy Gibbons goes, I've got some friends here who are going to call you and order some jackets. Put it on my tab.
No.
Oh, my God.
And we were like, are you fucking kidding me? We were like, what is going on? So we called Jaime like that afternoon with our measurements. And like I said to him, I was like, whatever was the last jacket that Billy Gibbons ordered, that's what I want. But in my size.
Yeah.
And my friend designed something a little bit different. And a couple months later, these jackets showed up at our door. So that's pretty
high
on the list.
That is unbelievable.
Yeah, that was pretty crazy. But now I'm kicking back to you guys. Who are the top guest experiences where you just can't believe you're in the room with that person?
This is when I get uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because I'm terrible at remembering. And I know I'm going to leave somebody out. I mean, they've all been great. They're all number one for me.
That just can't be true, though. That's just not
Dave
true.
Dave might have a hierarchy, but I just love all our guests.
Yeah.
No, when we had Tony Hale on, that was one of the first, it was maybe our eighth episode or something like that. It was really early on. But I just loved him so much. And it was I think partly because he's so great, I was nervous to interview him, and I was nervous for every interview at that point, but he was so great that I felt so at ease, and I had a genuinely great time. I think it was the first time on the podcast where I felt like, oh, it feels like we're just hanging out right now, you know?
He had a story. Some of how I think about these is like, if I can remember what happened during the interview that was either like really profound or funny or heartfelt, and he had a story about
swimming.
He had a story about swimming that I can't think about without laughing. And I just remember laughing. He's a friend. And every now and then I'll just text him, dude, I'm driving thinking about your swimming story. But like basically, like as a kid, he swam. And he said during the middle of a meet, he just like stopped swimming and stood up and looked at his dad and was like, I don't want to do this anymore. And I was like, just the image of a kid in the middle of a competition. Be like, nah. Nah, I think I'm done with this.
That was it.
Just
that's
like,
us
that,
down
that was it.
For the rest
just
of
like,
his life.
Yeah. Imagine this, and then you just see a kid standing in the water, just like breathing hard, looking at his dad, taking his cap off, like, yeah, I'm done. I'm not doing this anymore. It just kills me. But he was great. I mean, you know, McConaughey is just, that was just otherworldly, and especially where we were in the podcast, because it was like early days. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just he's such an icon, because it's one thing to get like actors, which we've had a few. But you know, he's such a substantial, just kind of personality, you know, so he was really fun. I had him tell a story at the end of the podcast that I've always wanted to hear him talk about. And it was really cool to have him actually tell that story. But then, you know, like John Mark Comer, who's kind of a theologian, who's one of my favorites. He's been on three different times, and it was really, his first time on was really cool. He has a book called The Ruthless Elimination of Hurry, just about how fast our lives are and how much we need to slow down. That's been revolutionary for basically everybody I know that's read it. And so, mm-hmm. you know, those were great. I mean, you know, like I said, Bruce Hornsby is just cool because it's Bruce Hornsby, you know, and hearing him talk about music. But I mean, I know this sounds cheesy, but I could go. We just had Leanne Mill. Leanne.
Morgan.
My gosh. I know a Leanne Miller. Sorry, Leanne Morgan, who's a comic. Who's, and I mean, we, I was sweating. I was laughing so hard. Yeah, like, genuinely.
She's hysterical.
That's always good.
Yeah. And what?
Yeah, yeah, no.
Well, and I was going to say, too, Bargatze. I mean, we were both yeah, really excited. That was one that, I mean, we've been excited about, but I think, you know, we kind of knew he was, again, in his ascendancy. And, you know, he's just so funny. And so I think it was, you know, that was one where I know we really felt like, man, this feels like kind of leveling up. You know, so he was great too.
That was a great interview. I was listening. You should go back and listen to it.
Okay, I'm nervous. Yeah.
When you started doing comedy, even because you started comedy relatively late in life, right? Doing, how'd you, because I always think I could be a great comedian. Like, I always go to Zany's or whatever and I go, I think I could do that.
Yeah.
Which is always the right sign that you probably could do it, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Is that arrogance? How'd you get past the suck phase? Because I feel like I could do it, but I don't know if I have the confidence to suck for
a
while.
You know, the suck phase for me was like middle school, just real life.
Yeah.
We were like, boy, that wasn't funny. You know, and then your friends are kind of like, nah, you know. And so the thing that's hardest to me about doing it is, and I'm going to speak for myself, but I may even be so bold to say the general public would not know, is that, you know, with music, you have, like, you always can just start a song. So even if what you're saying is not funny or interesting, you can just, like, kick the band and you're off to the race and people forgot that just happened. But the it is just dead time on stage feels like eternity. So if you don't, the flow of a set, like the masters who do it, you never notice the beats they're taking. It feels natural. And I think for me, those first few shows where I was just doing stand-up, it was like, oh my gosh. Like, I had to have a set list on the floor because I knew, like, I don't need to stall. I don't need to be like, oh shoot, where am I going with this? Because it needs to feel, because it feels like a million years between the last word you said at the end of a bit and the next. And so for me, I was really surprised. And Bargatze and I talked about this, but how every room is so different in the speed of that, because a bigger room, there's more reverb and it takes longer for people to laugh and there's more people laughing. But then a small room, it's like, I was flying through the set because, you know, you'd finish something and people laugh and then like 2 seconds later, they're kind of staring at you again. And so that was probably the biggest learning curve for me, was not even really being funny. It was just realizing, like, this thing has got to kind of breathe and move and ebb and flow. And if you're not, and then the other thing was, sometimes the funniest part of a story is the middle of it, but you still got to finish the story.
Yeah.
And so I would notice.
But is that poor writing? Like, should your stories be where the peak is at the end of the story?
We don't have to talk long about this. I kind of have a theory about comedy. I think there's two types of, I say this in the Bargatze thing. I kind of think there's two types of comics. There's people who are punchline comics, and then there's just funny people.
Yeah.
And I think funny people can get away without having punchlines because they're just funny.
Right. Like so Chappelle.
A Bill Cosby. Like,
yeah, yeah.
R.I.P.
Yeah.
To his social life. But, you know, it's like good storytellers, they're just kind of always entertaining.
That's kind of Bargatze, right?
Yeah, he's got his cadence and how.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I think if you're kind of like punchline centric, you do have to, you got to work it up to where, but I think like you can just, you know, if you think of good friends of yours that are funny, they're just kind of funny. It doesn't matter if the punchline was in the middle. So I had to work out, and I think I'm not a punchline guy. I don't know that I'm necessarily funny like that. But I just realized, like, oh, it's just about knowing, it's the confidence to know, even though that was the funny part, you still want to listen to me in the story.
Yeah.
Because it's just interesting. It may not be funny.
Where'd you do your first gig? How old were you when you started doing stand-up?
Oh, gosh. Well, the quick funny story about that is my manager came to me, this is probably 5 years into my career, and he's like, I think you need to do a stand-up show. And I was like, no. And he's like, here's what I'm going to do. No, actually, I said, I'll do it, but this is what I said. I will do it. I'm scared to death, so what you're going to have to do is book it and then tell me once it's booked and I can't get out of it.
That's how you got to do
That's
it,
exactly
right?
how to
do it. Yeah.
So he booked it at Bongo Java upstairs, or Fido. They have an upstairs theater.
No, Bongo Java.
Bongo Java.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. This on Belmont. And he said, we'll book it. And we booked two nights because it's only 50 people. And so he called me and he's like, hey, and sure enough, I was like, I'm not doing it. He's like, bro, it's, we can't get out of it. And I was like, damn, you know. So then
the people at Bongo are vicious.
Oh, they're just
bookers. So, if you screw them over,
you never get, you never work. You'll never work in this town again.
You cancel a Bongo Java show.
Yeah, and it's just ruthless. Kenny over there is just. But so what I did is then I invited 100 people. So I did 50 people of my friends the first night and 50 people of my friends the second.
That's not how I would do it. If I was to do it, I would book somewhere way out in Chattanooga where nobody would know me and just do that a couple times. That's what I would have done. I would not have done it the first time local in front of friends. Yeah. That's what you really did? Mm-hmm. And did it work out?
I mean, it was, you know, it wasn't well, that's totally why I wanted friends, because I wanted people to go like, hey, man. It ain't there.
Yeah.
It's something that could level with me.
Is that what they said?
Well, no. People were like, that was pretty funny. Like, because I just told things I always tell.
Yeah.
And then after that, it was kind of like I got the taste of it and was like, okay, I kind of do this. And then probably, I don't know, I did a Belcourt show for the public after that. I've never been more nervous for anything in my life. I was terrified. But it went pretty well. And then, you know, from there, you know, I did two different over the next like 5 years, two different like stand up runs where I did like five shows that were just me doing stand up. And then it was really fun. Cause it was like, oh, okay. It's like a thing here.
So what is the biggest takeaway for someone who's always thought they could do stand up is to book the show, is to book a gig.
Yeah.
And then prepare the material for it.
Yeah. I guess
that's what worked for you.
John and I've talked to a few comics and it's like, they tend to do it like they're building a new, like every time they rebuild sets, they start with 5 minutes, then 10 and then 15. Yeah. And so I know like Chris and, you know, some of my friends that are comics, they're like, you know, you do that. You go to Zany's and you get 5 minutes and you test stuff and then you kind of go. And I mean, you'll see them with pads, you know, that whole thing where they're like, all right, that didn't work. Or like, oh, that's great. I'll circle that. That to me is actually that's much scarier than a show. Because I don't want to workshop in front of people.
I want to be done.
I want to come out and feel like this is funny. I know it's funny. That's infinitely scarier to me than like getting up in front of 1,000 people and doing a set. I'm like, just let me do it. If it's not funny, it's not funny. I don't want to be like, what'd you guys think? Or like, oh, that's interesting. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
That's what I would do.
Yeah.
Yeah. John, did Billy Joel's music teach you how to play piano? Is that how you learned how to play piano? Was it from listening to Billy Joel?
No. But Billy Joel was he was sort of like early on when I was really young, I was already playing piano, like classical piano. I don't even remember life before taking piano lessons and stuff like that. But I remember seeing a video of Billy Joel early on and being like, that seems like an other thing. Like I wasn't connecting piano with Billy Joel, even though he was playing piano. It was nothing like what I was playing. But I just always wanted to be Billy Joel and then Elton John. And then it was Ben Folds. And then it slowly, like around college really was when I started writing songs. And then the whole world kind of meshed together.
What was it about Billy Joel that was just the fact that he was a rock star and you were playing piano and it felt like you could then play piano and do what he was doing? Like, was it just the fact that you were already playing piano and he was a piano player? Is that what drew you to him, or was it something else?
Yeah, probably. But I remember hearing Piano Man. It was everything about it, like down to the fact that he was wearing a sport coat like I would see my dad wear, but he had a T-shirt underneath. And that was like the most punk rock thing I've ever seen.
Yeah.
In central Indiana, we're sheltered from a lot of things. Well, so that slipped through.
I've never thought about this. Like, you can't, like, piano is just such a limiting factor on, not wardrobe, because Elton John, but like on just your ability to look as bad A as you can.
It's cool.
It's such a compressor. It's just keeping.
Yeah, like you see the Stooges and like he's got his shirt off. But you go sit at a piano and it's like, oh, the aesthetic changes a little bit.
If you're sitting down with your shirt off, you better be in
shape.
You
better be.
Because your love handles are rolling. Like you better be in serious shape to be sitting down shirtless at the piano. Yeah. You don't see it very often.
But it was like, and down to the lyrics of the song, like I didn't know what it meant, but I loved that he said, the waitress is practicing politics. Mm. Like there was something like, I knew that this was like serious. I knew this was connecting with people, and it was like a, there was like a heaviness to the song. It wasn't just like a kitschy, cool song, but I didn't understand it. But it was like, I want to do that. I want to be like, I want to write lyrics that are like meaningful and like serious, but and like, you know, wear a t-shirt under a sport coat if I could ever get away with that and not get arrested, you know.
What do you, so have you spent, I'm sure you've spent a lot of time studying his music, right?
Yeah.
So like what do you think are the takeaways? Because he wrote the entire catalog himself. Like, yeah. Is there any, can you take away anything studying his music that's a through line throughout it?
That's a great question.
Well,
thanks, Dave.
You know, yeah. I will say, let me start off with an asterisk. I mean, I've listened to his entire catalog, of course, lots and lots of times. And I've read his biography. And
it's getting a little braggy.
Oh, you read the biography.
I read the whole thing. I didn't listen to it.
Most of the guests, he doesn't read their books
fully. I didn't listen to it.
But for Billy, you read the
cover. If we could have Billy on Dadville, it'd be game over.
Oh, but, I've been dying to get him on. Maybe we could do it together. I've been dying to get him on forever. I can't figure out. He was my number one most listened to Spotify artist for like 3 years in a row.
Yeah,
now it's someone else. But for a minute, I had a great run with Billy.
Wait, who is it now? Just say it.
I actually can't. I can't tell you. I'd have to kill you. Okay. It was actually, what it was is there was a West End. I'm a big musical theater fan.
Oh, yeah.
There was a West End musical called Operation Mincemeat. When that album came out, I saw the show in London. It's one of the best shows I've seen in years. I listened to that cast album for like a full week. I was just obsessed with it.
Oh, yeah.
And that became my number one. From one week of listening.
That's the thing.
That became my number one artist.
Yeah. I couldn't
musicals
even post.
Will do it. I couldn't even post the graphic. Wait, but we have to get back to this question.
We will. We will. Just small digression. John and I have this funny game where I love asking people what the song that's in their head naturally the most. Yeah. So just like if you're walking around London and you find and you just start humming, what is it? John's is both Don't Get Around Much Anymore. Yeah. And oddly enough, Remember the Time by Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
Mine is the bridge of Then in the morning, Still Crazy After All These Years.
Oh, yeah.
That then goes into Come Back to Bed by John Mayer, which I found out was in the same key, and that's why. But you know what it's been? Here's where I'm going with this. You know what it's been this week out of nowhere is There's a Place for Us.
Yeah.
Which is out of nowhere.
Yeah.
But now that's what I've been singing all week.
That's how it goes.
What does it mean?
My taste has gotten better.
What does it mean, Dave?
That's the, to your point.
You know what's always in my head? Every time I'm in like a bathroom or I'm walking is I Won't Get Fooled Again by The Who. That's always in my head.
I love this
every
game
time just in a bathroom.
As much as I
like
a game.
I feel like whenever I'm washing my hands at like a wedding or a bar mitzvah or like something.
I wonder if it's like a sound always, that triggers it.
Maybe.
It's in the track. So, John, I have a question for you. I've messed it up.
The question was,
you read
what,
his whole
what was,
biography.
Like,
you listened to
you've done all this
catalog.
Research on Billy Joel. What have you learned? Especially musically speaking.
I mean, it's crazy, just his ability to write insane lyrics. I mean, all his music, like just his hits, really span some genres. I mean, you've got like some crazy like doo-wop songs that are sort of out of nowhere where the melodies and the chords are insane underneath there. And then I don't know. I mean, I've been trying to write my version of Piano Man my entire career. I don't know how he did that. I don't know how. And you listen to interviews where he talks about it.
He doesn't even like the song.
He hates all his stuff.
He hates
it seems
the stuff.
Like. He's always
can
like,
he, can
look
he
at this
give
melody.
It to someone?
It's not.
Could he just give you Piano Man to be like, I don't like it anymore?
But is there like a lyrical? I feel like the genius about his lyrics is. Maybe they're poetic, but they're so literal.
Mm-hmm.
Like to me, that's always amazing when someone can make a lyric seem so profound, but it's not really poetry or it's not vague.
Yeah.
It's pretty.
It's tricky because I was just on the road last month and I was listening through, I was driving through Allentown.
Yeah.
And I was listening through some of his stuff. And you're right. He does have, like, in my pursuit to be the best songwriter I can be, and Billy Joel being like the summit of the mountain, I sometimes listen to some of his lyrics, like on Allentown, and I'm like, maybe I'm overthinking this. Like, he's just kind of seeing, he is observing what's happening in this area at this time, and he's writing about it. But then you've got a line like that I think arguably is maybe the best just lyric of all time from She's Always a Woman.
What is it?
She'll ruin your faith with her casual lies. I'm just
that
like,
whole song
Just pretty much every line.
You can pretty
line.
Much take every line in that song, and it would be the best line in any song you've written.
Why is that a great line? She'll ruin your faith with her casual eyes. What does that mean?
You've got this faith. Yeah. It is like, you could build a whole story on that.
Yeah.
Like, the faith that you were born into, you have generations that your family is this thing. They're Jewish, they're Christian, yeah. they're Muslim, whatever. You have this faith, and then you have this whole story personally with that faith. You're trying to make it your own. You're growing up. You're yada yada. This whole story. This woman comes along with some casual, off the cuff. Who knows how much she even means this thing? It ruins your whole faith.
And here's why I think it's doubly genius. I don't hear it like that. I hear it like faith in her.
Oh,
so that's what makes it a great line. It's because always heard it like, you love this woman,
yeah,
and you're like, I know that we're supposed to be together. I trust you. I love you. And she's like, I don't know if this is working. And you're like, or like, you know, I don't know. Maybe I should be with somebody else. And you're like, I would posit that here's your hot take for the day. I really think, I mean, this is coming in screaming hot. If aliens came to Earth and said, okay, America, who best represents American music as a singer-songwriter? I think I'd say him.
It's got to be him, right? Who else? It's got to be him.
Only one that would give it a run for its money, but it's almost immediately disqualified in my brain, is Paul Simon. But Paul is too world music.
I don't think Paul even has, honestly, enough catalog.
Yeah.
Which is crazy to say, because it's some of the best catalog ever. But like, if you think about the range of sound and songs...
He's another one. I should do a whole list of this on Dave's Five Hot Takes, another podcast that I do, but you know,
shameless plug.
Thank you.
We'll cut that out. Don't worry.
No, please don't. Please don't.
I need the streams.
But it's like, I just don't. He is just, his breadth is so intense, and for some reason, I know people love and respect him. There's no doubt about that. But he's not in that sort of like pantheon. I don't think he's respected as Paul Simon is. And Paul Simon's an incredible talent, a generational talent. But Billy's much thicker than everybody. It's like the width of it, like John said, is so profound. And it's not just, because here's the biggest pushback, it's not just that he did it. Because it's one thing to just try to write a bunch of music and it be like, that's good. He had hits on those songs. So it's not just like, oh, let me do a doo-wop song and then a song about this random
like
town and
time or whatever.
Then like We Didn't Start the Fire or like, you know, Always a Woman. It's just, the thing is so unbelievably pressure, for Pete's sake. Like, it's so wide and so good. It's like the Beatles in that way to me, that they sort of went, his is even wider than the Beatles in my opinion though. But like, it's like, you know, you can do this really, really diverse. I mean, New York State of Mind. Just if he came to music and said, this is the only thing
I'm
giving to you.
Here's my one hit wonder.
People will be like, yeah,
yeah,
go to him up, send him on
I always think there's an interview where he's talking about Allentown, mm-hmm. and he talks about how the song was like so happy. It was like this cheerful thing. He was like, the lyric really had to make it work. Otherwise, yeah. it was going to be
yeah.
so corny.
Yeah.
And the opening line is, well, we're living here in Allentown, and we're shutting all the factories yeah. down. And right there,
yeah, you're in.
Be like, the song makes sense from that one line.
But just the melody after that, you're like, that is incredible, just that one moment. Anyway, he's just about untouchable. It breaks my heart that he hasn't written a song, what is it, 30
years? Well, no, he just wrote that song.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
But before that, it was 93 was his last.
Oh, my gosh.
I do wonder if something has to do, the fact that he's so... self-deprecating, I don't know if it's the right word. It feels like when you see interviews with him when he's talking about, you know, the intricacies of his songs, it always feels like he's talking about like building a table that's not that great of a table. He's like, I don't know. We just, you know, we needed legs and,
we
you
just
know,
built it.
So we just put the thing on the top. I mean, when you look at it, it's not that great.
Yeah. Wait, but you've done a similar dive with the Beatles mm-hmm. of just going super deep.
Mm-hmm.
I know
tell everybody who they are?
Yes. Do you guys really? I actually heard you say something in an interview that, like, when you started like 20 years ago, all the younger people, let's say, when you were writing, everyone knew who the Beatles were. And now you're in rooms and people are like, oh, I know who the Beatles are, but I don't really know the music.
Oh, yeah.
Really, though? That's so crazy to me.
Well, I think if you've got a human with a face and ears in the last, even, you know, obviously, 50 or 60 years since they've been around, but like, you know, you know, even if you don't know, you know,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, oh, you don't know, you know, Good Day Sunshine or some of their, you know, something or whatever,
yeah,
you know,
yeah, yeah.
Like, or, you're going to be like, yeah, yeah. Oh, no, I know that. You're
here
like,
comes the sun.
Yeah, like, here comes yeah, the sun. Yeah. That's exactly right. So it's not that you may, you know, it, you just don't know that you know it. It's
yeah,
too
yeah.
ubiquitous. That's the most ubiquitous music of all time. So you can't escape it. It's like,
what did you learn though, going so deep on the Beatles? Because I heard you say something that to me is fascinating, is a fascinating insight that you had about
them. Tell me what it is.
That maybe this number's wrong, but that there's only 20 Beatles songs that stay in the same,
key
for the entire song.
Yeah, it's insanity.
Isn't that crazy?
It's nuts.
Where'd you find that out, though? Or how'd you figure that out?
Because I just spelunked every inch of the internet trying to find information on them.
I mean, Dave, I don't know when it started, 2022. Dave went into, he formed his own cult where the members were him, John, Paul, George, Ringo.
Ringo, yeah.
Yeah.
And him again.
Dave was two of the members for most of the year. It really yeah. annoyed John.
Now, he yeah. really like went deep.
Give me your biggest learnings from going deep about the Beatles.
I can actually do this pretty quickly. One is that the keys of the songs, the fact yeah. that something like 88% of their songs leave tonal center, which is phenomenal. I think, you know, my buddy Destin Ransom, who was kind of my Sherpa through that journey, you know, he was like, it's scene changes. So it's not just key changes. It's like, Happiness is a Warm Gun or Good Day Sunshine, A Day in the Life. Like these, like you have kind of like one song and then you have another song for four bars, then you're back to the other song. So it's a real sense of like, which
Lucy
then would
and
be
the Sky with Diamonds.
Lucy and the Sky with
most
Diamonds.
Famous.
It's an incredible, you know, incredible example of that. But I think what that also infers is that nothing is precious. Like there's no part of anything that you can't mess up or change. And so, but then, and I would say, in the final thought, listening with my kids was probably the biggest tutorial because I could play some of the weirdest songs and they would still sing them because I would drive every morning and I'd take them to school and I would play it, you know, just to listen and recreationally and just to let them know their music. And, you know, my, at the time, 6-year-old would go, you know, I'd turn off the song and he'd be singing, and I was like, that, as much as anything about that band is the most profound to me, is that, you know, you can get a 90-year-old and they would love that song, and then you have a 6-year-old that would love
that
song.
What do you take away from that? Because it's easy to be like, oh, look how incredible that is. But as a songer, like, what do you take away from that that you can actually apply? Because you did an album
yeah, yeah.
where you were almost mm-hmm. like, it was the Feather Brain Wealth Motel. So like, okay, so that's something that's easy to understand, but like, is there anything you can actually take away from that of where you're going? Let me
well,
make
just,
complex th- songs.
Those were kind of my tenets.
That people can sing to.
It was like,
yeah.
if I wrote a song and had to sort of do those things, in my opinion, which was like, have some moment that kind of come out of nowhere or a key change was a big deal. That my kids liked it. I know it sounds ridiculous, but like I would play songs for them and literally kind of go like, I would turn the radio off after and I'd listen. If somebody was humming a part of it, it was like, all right, that's good. You know,
that's a good,
because
yeah.
to me, that's the thing about kids is they're just so pure in their affinity for something. There's no qualifying. There's no, if it's cool or not, it's just like, I want to sing that again or hear it again. And so for me, it was funny to sort of put it through that test of like, I'd work on a song and then I'd be like, hey, can I play something new? And then if I turn it off and they were, and I'd ask them, so what'd you think? I'd be like, meh. And it was like, oh, that's interesting, you know.
Yeah.
So that was a really fun. I mean, this is probably embarrassing to say, but I don't know that in my whole career I ever thought that way about a song's the ability to remember a song, which is really dumb because any successful song I'd be like, well, isn't that what we're trying to do here? But I think I've got enough of a folk bend in me that I'm like, no, it's got to have a meaning. It's got to, like, if the chords are good enough, it justifies itself, or the
yeah.
melody's cool enough. But I think the Beatles were really good in reminding me, like, no, but you kind of want people to, like, want to listen to it at
yes.
some point.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Up for a third time, for a fifth time. Mm-hmm. And I think that record was a real 20-plus years in a songwriting career. It was almost like I had to learn, oh, yeah. Like there's some, that's their key, is that no matter how weird those songs get, there's some part of it you want to hear again. Which is kind of like the most, you know, pure part of music. It's just like, do you want to go listen to it again for whatever reason?
Yeah. To me, the key change thing is profound. Like now, I think everyone's freaking out about the Sabrina Carpenter song "Please, Please, Please" because it has that key change in the second verse. But like, you never hear key changes.
It's really
in
rare.
Country music
ever.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, is there even a song? I mean, I'm sure there is somewhere in the catalog. Like,
there
but
used
not
to be
since like the '90s.
I was gonna say, It's funny. I actually, this random you asked, since me and the guys our shows last week, we were listening to country songs with key changes. And it was like so much
of the
90s.
What's an example of one?
There's just a song called Only Love by Wynonna that Marcus Hummin wrote. Anything Marcus Hummin wrote is going to have some key changes.
It's going to happen.
Which John's written with Marcus.
Yeah.
That's one. There's a Steve Warner song called Weekend that has two crazy key changes. There's actually there's more than you think. I mean, This Kiss has a crazy key change. I mean, like John said, the 90s had actually a ton of them. But here's the thing, and this is the last thought because I'm beating a dead horse, but the thing with really good key changes, you actually feel them, but you don't even notice them. And you'll realize, that was something that I really learned too in that time, listening to Beatles as much as I did, was like, I would always know, like, because I'd feel it. I'd be like, oh, I'm more excited, or I feel weird, or I feel really unsure. And before I knew what it was, I'd go, oh, that's cool. Or I love this chorus. And it's like, oh, well, you know why? Because we just moved up a whole step. And you feel that lift in the melody. But like, there's actually a lot of that in country music that if you go back, especially in the 90s, you kind of go like, oh, yeah, they did that. I forgot that's a weird.
I do love that second verse in that Sabrina Carpenter song has that change.
Yes.
I love it. It's such an odd decision. It's a weird, because you definitely feel it. It makes me wonder, like, the average kid walking around singing that song a cappella in their head, I'm like, are they hitting that second verse correctly? You know what I mean?
Like, are they singing, are they getting
singing
the key change?
And then are they going back to the key?
Well, you know why they said they did that? Because I was watching an interview with Jack Antonoff, and they said that the lyric on it is, I have a strange idea, babe, or it's like, I have an idea, babe. And he wanted that verse to feel like, I have an idea up here. And then the chorus was back down to more reality, he was saying. So that's why they go back down to the original key.
Yeah.
So the verse is like, I have an idea.
But
and it's like, you're all the
way
over
here.
Here's
the thing that I think is so tricky about music today is like, you know, so much of the music from that time was informed by the music before it. And that was replete with key changes. I mean, it was like everything, you know, because a lot of it came from musicals. And so McCartney was... You know, so he's just used to hearing melodies that change keys.
Right.
So if he was going to sing you a song when he was 25, I guarantee you it was going to change key, whatever was happening in his head. And I think what scares me is that when we don't listen to that kind of music that has real depth and breadth, you don't know you can do it. And so what naturally comes out of you doesn't do that because it's just not what you're exposed to. Whereas I think like those generations before us, all the music they were being informed by had a million of those things.
Right.
I also love that Jack Antonoff was let himself be like, emotionally, the lyric, I want this to feel this way. Because that is something that like you could do all day on Broadway. Not Broadway Nashville, but Broadway.
Yeah, right.
In a musical, that's par for the course. But I feel like, I don't know, at some point we decided like, that's too corny or kitschy or whatever. Like the music's got to stay right here.
Or maybe too smart. Maybe the audience isn't gonna follow it, is what you think, or it's not gonna, they're not gonna know what's going on.
I hope that happens more and more.
Yeah, you guys are both songwriters, artists. You guys tour a lot. You do the podcast. You do a lot of different things. Is there any place where you guys receive revenue where it might be surprising to know that you actually receive revenue from that place?
Probably the podcast.
Is it the podcast?
I mean, you know, it's not like change your life money, but we do have ads, so it's nice because, you know, it's just a good feeling just that, you know, that you can do something you enjoy like that probably, I think both of us didn't see coming, and to make any money off it, it's really fun because you feel like, oh, yeah, it's like
when Dave had the idea to do the podcast, I never thought, I just never thought like money's going to come from this. That was never a thought. And also, like, intentionally, I was like, don't run this through little machine of shame and judgment and, like, let this be this fun thing that you and Dave get to do. You know, all my music and stuff like that, if I'm doing a photo shoot, it's already in that thing. I'm like, I hate it. That one looks okay. You know, don't do that. So, like, making money from
So every month when we get an email from our network, I'm always like, really?
We're gonna get what network are you guys on?
That sounds fun.
Andy, that sounds fun. Network, gotcha.
But I mean, probably that, honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe.
Although every now
music, our music.
Yeah, that the fact that it still makes money. Yeah.
And where does it make? Is it like BMI or like ASCAP?
All
like
the PR, things.
Just everything.
Yeah. It's a myriad of ways that it comes in.
Yeah.
And then every now and then I'll get booked for like a stand-up show. Like
really?
Like I've done a couple of corporate things where they were like, "Oh no, we want your stand-up," and I'm like, "Oh, okay. Well, that's awesome." That's always really surprising. I'm like, "Oh, okay." Okay.
That shouldn't be surprising.
Yeah. Where's the confidence,
you
Dave?
Shouldn't be paid for
that. Okay, wait. We're wrapping up here. We're running out of time. Before we wrap up, this is the clip that can maybe go viral. Okay. This is what we're going to do.
Sit up.
Let's do it.
Can we get... We've got Dave Barnes here and John McLaughlin, lifelong Billy Joel fans and Beatles fans. Mm-hmm. Can we get the top three for your artist? Let's start with John, with the top three Billy Joel songs for you.
I mean, Piano Man's got to be on there. And So It Goes.
Oh my God.
He says that's one of his favorite songs too. If you
really?
There's an interview where he is asked to list his top five and he says, "And So It Goes."
Yeah. That song. And
why
again,
is that? Why do you love that song?
I don't know. I was so young when I heard it. I just was drawn to that kind of I like kind of sad music. Yeah.
You know how many key changes are in that song? I actually have no clue. I don't think it's any.
I don't think it changes. But I played some shows with Billy.
No, you didn't. Really?
And I wish if I could go back, because you know, anytime you're gonna meet like your heroes, you think about like, okay, what's my vibe gonna be?
Yeah.
Am I gonna come in and be
what's my vibe gonna be?
You have to determine like,
am I a fangirl?
Am I gonna fangirl?
Am I gonna be a peer?
Exactly.
What am I gonna do? Am I gonna talk music or am I gonna talk about my lunch?
And I just wish I would have just fanboyed out a little more.
Yeah.
But fanboyed out in like, can we sit and talk about some of your music? Because I really think he would have. I just didn't. I was like, he's not. Based on a lot of the interviews that I'd seen with him, I'm like, I don't know if he'll like to do that. But after spending some time with him, I was like, I think, looking back, I'm like, I think he would have done that. I think he would have had a good time doing that. I wish I would have. So, Piano Man, And So It Goes. I don't know. It's so hard. I mean, maybe New York State of Mind.
New York State.
Yeah. I don't know. It's too hard.
I'm cheating.
Yeah. Are you going to do Billy Joel 2 or are you going to do the Beatles?
No, I'm going to do Billy Joel 2.
Okay, you do Billy Joel 2.
No, you're not taking
And then we'll compare lists and I'll send both to him. Yeah.
She's Always a Woman.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. Is it the greatest love song ever? I mean, it's on the...
Certainly not the greatest.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I would add it's going to be probably... these will be the other two. I really love Just the Way You Are.
Mm.
I love that song. And then it would be a toss up between this is impossible. I mean, Only the Good Die Young is on there.
Oh, my God. I can never not listen to that. I can listen to that song.
And I love Don't Ask Me Why. I mean, it's really hard. Yeah. I can't. I got to get out. I'll just keep saying
I was just thinking about as you guys were going, I think Miami 2017 is probably my favorite Billy Joel song.
Oh, wow.
Hands down, because it rocks, but it's got a great story to it. It's funny. It's like a whole thing, and I just think it's killer. Downeaster Alexa.
Yeah, that's a killer.
Freaking love.
Yep.
And then none of you guys said Scenes from an Italian Restaurant.
Yeah, that doesn't make the list for me.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, even I being that the song, Beatles fan that you are,
no.
That's like his Abbey Road, I feel
it
like.
It is.
Yeah.
I forgot this would be my number three, was Goodnight.
Goodnight.
Oh my gosh,
Goodnight,
that song,
Saigon.
It makes me cry.
Yeah.
No.
Oh, Goodnight.
My Angel, that
Goodnight,
song.
Goodnight, My Angel.
The lullaby.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God.
Isn't the song called Goodnight Saigon, too?
Saigon, yeah.
Yeah. Gotcha.
He
okay.
He likes a lot of Goodnight.
So,
So Beatles, for me,
yeah.
Yesterday has got to be just the number one. Yesterday is like, if I had to play the greatest song of all time, I mean, I would be picking between Yesterday and a couple others, you know? It's like my number one song for like if somebody were to ask you like what's one song that you would wish you have written yourself. It's just a perfect song.
Yeah.
Hey Jude, and then Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds.
Yeah,
I would say.
Okay, I think I can actually be fast at this. Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. I will.
Mm.
And then it would either be Obladi, which I love that song so much. In My Life is also, I'm cheating here in that list.
In My Life is maybe the best song of my sister. She just had a baby about 9 months ago. And I was in the room like the day that the baby was born. And I was like holding it. And I was like, I'm going to pick the first song that this baby ever hears.
I love that
and
so
I picked
much.
In My Life by the Beatles.
Really?
And now every time I'm around her, I play it, and I'm trying to see if I can brainwash her early to be a Beatles fan.
No, that's great.
Wouldn't it be like, great if she grows up and that's her song that's always in her head every
day? That's what I'm hoping.
You can program
that's
kids.
That's what I'm trying to see if I can accomplish with
this little girl. I think that's the thing about the Beatles is I think there's no easier time. There's no better band and a better time than kids and Beatles.
Yes.
Because it is the most... I really think of any other music, it's probably the easiest music for kids to like.
Yeah.
Because it's crazy. That's, again, their superpower. But, I mean, my kids love the Beatles.
Yeah.
And it was so easy. It wasn't like, no, trust me, like Steely Dan, like, you got to really start with, like, do it again.
Yeah, nine chords.
It's like, nah.
See, I got to go Lady Madonna for me.
Oh, I love that song.
It's just so fun. Can I go the full B-side of Abbey Road starring with a...
Oh, the whole, back half.
Starting with, when does that start? With Golden Slumbers?
Carry That
or
Weight.
Carry
it's
that,
like one of my favorites.
Yeah. I'm going to group that as one thing.
Yeah, it's cheating, but sure.
No, but it's my show. And then I'm going to go with, what's my third? Probably In My Life.
Yeah.
I mean, he was 25 years old when he wrote that song.
No, you know,
like, how
Paul
did he write that song?
Paul was 21 when he wrote Yesterday.
Yeah.
He was like 22 or 3 when he wrote Blackbird. You're like... What are you guys doing?
Yeah,
like
drugs. You were talking about, though, because I said to you before we started recording in Let It Be, there's who screams, oh, F.
That's Paul.
Paul.
Yeah, because he hit the wrong chord.
Because he hit the wrong, and you can actually hear him say it on the recording if you listen.
And I didn't
closely.
Realize there was a, there was, it was actually a big deal back then because they, I think somebody heard it and tried to like get him in trouble for it, but they said, oh, that's not what I yelled, but it was.
But it was. It Why was. Are you so convinced that that is what they yelled?
Because it is what they it yelled. Is what... No, you can hear it.
I know, you can hear it too.
And now you can get the tracks.
Yeah.
And so you hear it.
And you just hear it, if you Absolutely. Listen to it, it's right before the na-na-nas come in, right? Mm-hmm. Or the yeah. Mm-hmm. He just goes, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
Dadville on the podcast, Dave Barnes, John McLaughlin. What do we need to plug? You've got this great Beatles album. Out. I always have to look at the title because it's so
weird.
Complicated. Feather-Brained Wealth Motel, which it came out a couple years ago, but it's a great record.
Oh,
and everyone
thanks.
Probably
it's
tells you
record.
That.
Well, you know,
it's a great record.
This is a great setup. Thank you both for that. Yeah. We're doing the deluxe edition. It's been out a year at the end of this month, at the end of October. We're doing a deluxe edition where we're adding 3 songs that didn't make the record that we recorded. And then we're doing 3 demos.
Mm.
And I'm really excited about that because I think the songs that didn't make it are just as good. It just didn't make sense on the record. Then the demos are really fun because a couple of them are like way different than what we ended up with. So it's fun, you know, doing that.
And you're on the road. You're both on the road playing shows. You guys have some City Winery dates coming up, I think, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're everywhere. John, what else? What you got going on? What can we plug for
can
you?
Can I plug something for
yeah,
you?
Yeah.
Please.
I'm really excited about this. John has a side project called Mood.
Mm-hmm.
So John, for people, I know people know this about John, but like, John's piano playing is truly prodigious, like genuinely. I mean, I don't throw that word around a lot, but he's not just a great, everybody knows him as a great singer-songwriter, but he is a phenomenal piano player, like phenomenal.
That's
like,
kind. Thank
no,
you.
It's incredible. It's substantial, his ability to do that. I think especially in light of people not knowing that he does it as well as he does. Because you see him live and it's like, oh, he's a great player. But it's incredible. And he has this project called Mood that he writes. It's just piano music. And it's one of Annie and Mott's favorite things. He's putting out a Christmas Mood record, which gets me so excited. So I am, as a fan, extremely
excited. Christmas Mood.
Yeah, so it's going to be Christmas tunes that are just piano.
Yep, that's it. That's what I was going to say.
Yeah.
That's it. So. And get it on Spotify.
Yeah, I was going to say word for word everything that you just said.
That he just said. Ain't beat you to it.
Let me tell you what people don't know about me. I'm a prodigiously good
at And I don't throw that word. But let
me, and let me, I don't use that word lightly.
Well, I'll tell you, one of the things that gets me so, it's like one of the things in my life that I feel, one, I'm so thankful that I do this for a living because I get to know people like John who does what he does. And then two, I'm so thankful I live in Nashville that I have proximity to people like John who are as good as what they do. And then three, I'm thankful my kids can be around. But every now and then we have a piano in our front room and John and his family live across the street. And, you know, we'll be hanging or something. And John will just go in and play. And it's especially fun when he's working on a classical piece because, you know, those are so aerobic and so demanding. You know, it's for me to sit in a room while he does that, it's just like it is the coolest thing. You know, because you're in proximity to this incredible talent, these incredible pieces of music. And I just get so geeked. I just feel like I can't believe I get to do this. Like, people would pay so much money to sit and listen to somebody play. Yeah. And then my kids will walk in. I just think, you guys don't realize what you're witnessing. I mean, he was working on Rhapsody in Blue, and he would come over and play it. And it's just like, it's divine. It's like seeing this music and this guy who can do it. And then you just realize, like, what he's having to physically do. Like, how far his hands, it's just, and every now and then, like, we haven't done it in a while, but he'll be working on something, and I'll just go, hey, play me something you're working on, you know, of a piece, because he's always working on pieces, and it's just incredible. It's like, how many people can do this in the world? And then, you know, this guy that I know really well lives across the street and does this,
and
you know?
He can do it.
And he can do it. It's incredible.
And then Dave can come over and do like a tight 5 minutes for my girls.
And I just sort of.
And I'm like, just, you need to know. You go,
goddamn, only in Nashville.
Tight five.
Only in Nashville.
Tight five.
If I could play piano, I would just play Rhapsody in Blue all day.
It is.
That's what I would do.
And it was fun hearing him. I didn't realize this, how demanding that piece is. Like, I know now because John's taught me, and Ransom and some of my friends have been like, hey, is that hard? And like, oh, dude, it's about impossible.
Yeah.
So it was really fun seeing him.
Like, Dave became obsessed with the Beatles. I became obsessed with Rhapsody in Blue.
Yeah.
Like, to the point, I was waking up at like 4 a.m, going back to my little studio and just like opening it. And I'm like, I'm on page 17.
Because you have to go measure by measure. That's the only way to learn
it,
right? Like,
I would have to take days off and ice my hands because I was overdoing it.
How insane is that?
I mean, have you seen Bela Fleck play it on the banjo?
Actually, I think you sent me a video of that.
Not the banjo part, because there is a banjo part in Rhapsody in Blue.
Yeah. I didn't know.
He
that.
Plays the whole arrangement on the banjo.
Yeah.
And crazy. You know, sorry, last thing. I geek so hard on this stuff. I think the thing that I think is so cool about that is not just that people can play it, that someone sat down and wrote that.
Oh my gosh.
That's
a different
stuff,
language.
Oh, that's the thing. Because I think anyone with enough time could learn how to play Rhapsody in Blue. If you gave me 5 years, I could show up and play Rhapsody in Blue. Not that that wouldn't take dedication or whatever, but to write it, that's the thing, right?
Well, and John has really helped me understand about that, those kind of, I know Rhapsody in Blue is not really classical music, but just that, like, that era of classical, that it's not just like I think that's why you have to see somebody play it, because it's one thing to listen to it, but when I watch John play these pieces, you're like, how do you do that? Like, how do you physically, you know, you're doing like 4-octave sweeps, one hand is doing, and you're like, somebody wrote that, like, and you know, had somebody obviously that could play it, or you wouldn't have written it, you know. And just to think the ability, like you said, not just that you're doing it, but like somebody was like, okay, no, I think you can physically, okay, if I do that, then I'll have him do the left hand. Okay, no, that's possible.
And then they had to, like, they had the idea, but then eventually you got to go to sleep.
Yeah.
And then you got to, like, now I can just pull out the iPhone and be like, all right, here's.
You had to write it. If
he had
to remember,
like,
it.
And then he had to wake up the next morning and remember what the idea that he, you know what I mean?
What's the hardest part in Rhapsody in Blue? Like, what section took you the longest?
Oh my gosh, we could do this. Should be a whole other episode.
And can you sing the section so we know which
well,
section?
Well, here's why Rhapsody in Blue is particularly challenging. I mean, for one, it's like if I sat down and played it right now, it'd take 15 minutes. It's
a huge piece. Just to memorize it.
It's
insane.
One of those songs that, like, everybody knows, like, a couple of the melodies.
That part.
But you don't, no one sits and listens to the whole thing unless you're, like, way into this kind of stuff. But what makes it so hard is there's so many places in there where the tonal center is out the window. Mm.
where like I have the entire thing memorized except for two measures. There's two measures close to the end. It's like the second to last page where he's doing this. I can't even. It's like, you know, it makes no sense because there's no, you're not playing chords. What are you doing? You're playing these weird chords, but they're changing chromatically, but not at a one-to-one ratio going down. You don't know what you're playing.
I'm imagining, I just had the funniest image in my head where Gershwin is like, all right, Johnny, you took it home. What do you think? And he says exactly, he's like, what are you doing? What is...
These two what measures here. Two what measures? Are they? I don't. There's so many spots that are incredibly challenging. That you know, it's the most challenging piece of music I've ever learned.
That's incredible. Think about that.
See, that's so cool to have that though. Like, yeah. I don't know what that would be for me on guitar, but like, that's so cool to know to have that to be able to do it.
But I will say, this is not the hardest part. But there's a section of it. That is one of the more recognizable. It's like the
oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like page 21 or whatever. And I mean, you talk about going measure by measure. Like I would like mark off goals. Like on September 5th, I want to be at this measure, and it's like the third, and I'm like three measures away.
By the way,
yeah.
So I was obsessed, but I couldn't wait to get to this one section so that I could play it because it's one of the easier sections to play, but the tones are so genius and beautiful. And I was back in my little writer shed. It's 4:30 in the morning. I'm finally there, and I'm playing it. And by this part, I'm reading it, but I can like actually play it in real time, and I'm sobbing. Because it's so, I could cry talking about it right now. It's so beautiful. It's like, it's one of the most, Clair de Lune and this section of Rhapsody in Blue, I think are the most beautiful pieces of music ever written. Wow. You know?
Come on, man.
That's so good. We should go, can we come and hear him? Or you could perform it? Let's go over it and hear him do it.
So Sean Hayes performed it when he did Goodnight Oscar.
I saw him do it. Yeah.
You saw it.
Yeah, I saw it. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He performed it every single night.
Yeah.
If I ever meet Sean Hayes, that's my first question.
Is what? Yeah, yeah.
How did you play that song every night?
Yeah. That's what I won him the Tony for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's incredible.
That's
I can't imagine performing it in front of people.
How are you going to learn these? Last question, then we're in overtime. How are you going to learn these last two measures? It kills me that you've got these two measures.
I could sit down and play the whole thing from memory right now, and there's a 50-50 chance that I'll play those two measures correctly.
That you'll do it, yeah.
I got the gist of it, and I could fake my way through it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But there might
be
some
weird
things.
But think about what he just said. A 15-minute piece of music.
There's two
he can play measures from memory.
It's
that's insanity.
What's crazy about the human body. Like you play through these things and your brain is supposed to just, it seems impossible, but then through muscle memory, and there's something magic about music, you're able to retain it and learn it. It's like a different part of your brain.
That's unbelievable. You know? It's the coolest thing.
Dadville on the podcast right now. Dave Barnes, John McLaughlin.
This was really fun. Thanks for having us.
Thank you guys for coming
in.
Thanks to Jason, producer Jason, for setting this up.
DJ.
Jason.
You got to listen to the podcast Dadville, wherever you listen to podcasts. You got to see these guys live. They're on the road. You got to stream the music.
Yep.
Listen to Rhapsody in Blue, shameless plug for George
Double
Gershwin.
G.
and that's it. Guys, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you.
These guys are real-life dads, by the way. It's not just a shtick.
Yeah. Yeah.
These guys are...
We can prove it.
We can't speak to the quality of dad, but we are dads.
That's not a part of it. That was never a promise we made.
That was never the promise that was made.
They knew the deal.
And we're out. Wrap it.
Do you think there's another podcast today that shouted out George Gershwin?
Today?
Yeah.
No.
There's not. Yeah.
I think there are Gershwin podcasts that didn't plug Gershwin as hard as we did.
Yeah, as we just plug Gershwin.